Oh, here's Donald Sutherland. All right. Bring him in, man.
Wow. Look at him.
Yay.
Got his suspenders on and a tie.
He's bringing his luggage in.
Yeah, I wouldn't leave my Donald Sutherland luggage around.
Oh, my God, this could be interesting.
What?
There's a discussion going on.
He's a good guy.
Yeah.
What's the discussion about?
I don't know.
What are they talking about?
I don't know.
What are they talking about, Roland?
Roland? Why? The Roland, his acting's getting worse and worse.
I know.
Roland's as the years panicking. Go by. Panicky Pete Roland. Ah, Donald Sutherland. Hello, sir. I don't know. What are they?
What kind of microphones?
Probably cheap ones from this company.
Cheap. Sure. Very cheap.
This company isn't known for...
Can I have a U87?
Exactly. See? Here's a guy that knows his stuff.
Yeah. Why are you carrying your own luggage? You're making everyone nervous. You're rolling your own luggage, sir.
I am?
Yes.
The mics do work better when you pull them in front of you.
You smell really good.
Does he smell good?
Oh, he smells great, yeah.
What does he smell like, Jimmy?
Just really good cologne.
Like
very
rich.
Clean. Yeah, you smell
like
good.
Success.
I'm sitting beside someone who can't tell the difference between perfume and flatulence.
I see them as one and the same.
Yeah.
No, you smell great.
I really appreciate that you guys have water and tea and all that stuff. It's nice.
And why wouldn't you?
Do you want something?
I have no idea why I don't, but just no one
offered. You do have water. That is your
That's
water.
That's real.
Do you want something else, sir?
Unopened.
I'd love a cup of black tea.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
We'll get some black tea. Wow, you do smell good.
Yeah.
Man. Permeating the room.
Yes.
I like it.
Thank God, because this place stinks.
It's success, and it's successful movie. That's what it is.
Everybody came out. You know, the Twitter feeds all said it was an A+.
Yeah.
Which is great, you know, because an exit poll nowadays can kill a movie.
Mm-hmm.
And this one is just... But it's people keep saying, you know, I don't want to go see it. It's a movie for kids. It's not a movie for kids. It's a movie for adults.
It's living up to the hype, too. Yeah. Like, a lot of times, like you're saying, if you pre-hype a movie... There's nowhere to go but down from there, but what an opening weekend.
Yeah, this one's got everywhere to go up.
Yeah.
You know, there's a movie for the 99%. It has a chance. When I read the script, I didn't know anything about the books. When I read the script, I said, my God, this could allow young people to feel that they can determine their destiny, you know? And it's great.
Do you feel when a movie's this successful that... would you rather have a successful movie monetarily or something that you really are happy with and proud of doing?
I'm happy with this and I'm proud
of
doing
it. Yeah, that's what I mean. It's like, it's amazing. You've got both
successful
as far as this is concerned.
And if it can in some way organize young people, you know, it's been a pretty dormant generation. I read the other day the Port Huron statement that the SDS produced in 1962, 50 years ago. It was wonderful, and we have nothing like that today.
The STS?
SDS.
I know what that means, but they don't. What is it?
Students for a Democratic Society.
Oh, SDS. I got the wrong letters.
And you said STS.
No, DS stands for Donald Sutherland. who booked me into this?
Exactly. Look at it.
Can we?
To be serious.
Were you very active growing up as far as social?
I was
social...
active growing up. Yeah, I you know, I grew kind of a foot a year.
No, see? That because he is tall.
No, he's very
active,
tall.
Active politically, no. Yeah. I was no. I'm from Nova Scotia.
Yeah? You're Nova Scotia, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, a Canadian.
Where men are men and sheep are afraid of us. Are you a Canadian?
No, but I have friends that are Canadians.
No, so we're not fellow Canadians.
Did you hate the way he tried to bond with you on that, and then you realized he's from Long Island?
Really. Our neighbors to the north. Yeah, I'm just from... Yeah.
That was Long creepy. Island. Are you from Canada? Really, you too? Yeah. No, Long Island.
Right. Well... one of their glaciers ran over Long Island. If I could try to put the
connection
there somewhere.
You know, Hunger Games, third best opening weekend of all time, should be mentioned while Donald Sutherland's in the studio.
That includes franchises. That includes Harry Potter 2 and one other one. I can't remember which one it is. It's the best opening weekend.
That was a franchise. Or a sequel.
No, a sequel, yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
gotcha.
This is not yet a franchise until the second one comes out.
$155 million so far.
Pretty good. Hope you got a piece of that.
You got a piece of the action?
Well.
Okay, really a downer, right? when John Landis, he had been a gopher on
I know the story.
On Kelly's Heroes. And
he was.
Do you want to tell it? Or
oh, yeah, no, I know the animal.
I don't want to spoil it.
No, I know the Animal House story.
That's what I mean.
Oh, okay, sorry.
He was a gopher on Kelly's Heroes.
Oh, wow,
and
I didn't
said,
know that.
And MASH came out when I was over in Yugoslavia, and he said, okay, I'm going to be a great director. I said, well, if you're going to be a director, I'll be in every film. So I was in Kentucky Fried Movie and all that kind of, just playing a waiter or whatever. And I was shooting Invasion of the Body Snatchers, and he said, come over up to Eugene, Oregon, and do a day on this, playing a professor who smokes dope. And I said, okay. He said, Universal wants to offer you 2% of the profit. I said, Universal? 2%? No.
Oh, no.
I said, they need to pay me my daily rate. So they did.
2% of Animal House, huh?
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, you know.
Forget about the Neumann U87.
Do you know what would 2% roughly have translated into? Do you have any estimate?
Or
have you just tried to block it?
He doesn't want to know.
If the figure 2 million comes into your mind.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, I would think it would probably be a lot of money.
Were you surprised in 80 when Ordinary People beat Raging Bull for Best Picture, or did you kind of feel like it was going to?
I don't think about those kind of things, to be truthful. I mean, Marty's movie was wonderful. Bobby was fantastic in it. It just appeals to a different audience. That year, Jack Lemmon won Best Actor.
De Niro won for Raging Bull.
Well, then that wasn't the same year, because the same year... I don't know. Jack won... Maybe it was
Redford won director for Ordinary People, and Ordinary People won Best Picture, and I think De Niro won Best Actor.
Oh, did he? Okay.
Why are you arguing with Donald Sutherland?
Oh, I'm not. I'm helping.
No,
helping.
He's helping me. Yes. I'm 76 years old. I need whatever I can get. And I want to thank you very much for the tea.
I told him have water and tea ready, and they just don't do it. We have the water, but no tea. I just keep trying to pass the water to
him.
Here comes
the tea.
I know.
Here comes the tea right now.
Oh, was
here
that his tea?
I bet it's in a plastic cup.
It better.
I think it's in. Is that his tea?
Yes.
A real tea.
No, it's in
don't spill it.
Can you believe it?
It's in a Starbucks.
It should be in the bone cup.
You're trying to poison me. Yeah.
Put it in the bone cup, Barbara.
Do you prefer a glass to drink your tea out of? Because I know Bill Cosby likes to drink out of a glass and not...
Anything other than plastic or paper.
Oh, boy. We are screwing up by the numbers here today.
Oh, no, I'm just being a complaining old
Richard.
No. It's a fantastic movie.
Yes.
Jennifer Lawrence... I said somewhere that she should be called Jennifer Lawrence Olivier. She's just a great actor.
Yeah.
You know, and Gary is a brilliant writer. Those scenes at in the Rose Garden in the movie, did you see the movie?
I have not seen the movie yet.
We couldn't get tickets.
It was sold out all weekend.
We could not get tickets.
It's the big city, New York. Kind of hard to,
Sam saw it, though. We're going to see it.
Swear.
He's going to kill us.
I've seen every Donald Sutherland movie.
You've seen almost everyone. You haven't seen this.
I haven't seen Little Murders.
Little Murders.
Little Murders.
Little Murders.
What a great film.
But he's
the odds are not good. It's very, very funny. Very funny movie.
But the look he's given us, I got to tell, we live in Manhattan. We could not go see this movie. And they won't give us a screener copy, obviously.
And they won't,
it was sold out the entire weekend.
They won't give us copies, which some films do. But films of this size never give out screeners.
No.
So we couldn't see it ahead of time.
They don't give out screeners because there's so much problem with
pirating art.
All I'm saying is, we wanted to see the movie before you got
these
here.
Video cameras doing? Because otherwise I would have dressed.
You look
terrific.
You look great.
No, wonderful. No, seriously.
Do you look great?
I think it's, what do they do with that?
We just videotape every interview.
Yeah?
Uh-oh. Turn those cameras off.
What do you do?
No. I don't know. I just needed to know.
I don't know.
Okay. All right. Great pleasure being on you.
do you like Little Murders was 71. No one... It talks about it like, you know, I mean, back then they did. It's such a fucking great underrated comedy.
Yeah.
It's a great movie.
Alan. Gosh, he was funny. Anyway.
Who, Elliot Gould?
No. Elliot, you know, Alan, when he directed it.
Oh, I don't know who directed it. Vincent Gardenia's in it. Mm. And Donald just plays like this really weird...
I play a minister.
Hippie minister.
Weird. Everybody says, no, he's very straight.
It was a bizarre for that movie. Maybe because it was kind of seemed like it was the juxtaposition of him to Vincent Gardenia. He was supposed to be kind of like a shocking presence.
Little Murders was a Jules Feiffer script.
Okay,
yeah.
That's funny.
Well, now I got to see that.
I know.
Now I got to see Hunger Games. And
Carol,
and
I've never heard that name on a man before. You were just fantastic. Yeah. That and JFK are my two favorite Sutherland
monologue
moments.
Oh, right, right, yeah.
By the way, a lot of people trying to help you out, Donald. They know how much money you would have made from Animal House.
No.
JFK.
That's no help.
JFK took 3 months to prepare.
For that?
Yeah. Well, it was whatever it was, 20 minutes, right. 20-minute mm-hmm. monologue. And you can't memorize it. I mean, you could memorize it and right. just say mm-hmm. the words. But to make it real, you have to have it so profoundly absorbed
wow.
that you can answer a telephone in the middle and then go right back to what you're saying because it's in your head like it's really in your head.
Is that what you did? Did you research everything and just until you knew it backwards and forwards and then just kind of speak it out?
I had done a lot of the research earlier because I had produced a film called Executive Action, which was about that. And Fletcher Prouty was somebody that I admired and believed in. And, anyway.
Well, he was the guy. Wasn't it based, your character X was based on two people. It was based on Fletcher and somebody else.
Go see The Hunger Games. It's a wonderful movie. It really is. It's a wonderful movie for adults.
He's a promoting machine.
No, I'm not like a promoting that. That's machine. It's just, did I research what?
No, I'm saying was X based on Fletcher and somebody else or somebody else?
No, it was written. No, Fletcher. Fletcher probably was there. Fletcher and Oliver Stone. Oliver Stone has a piece of everything.
People actually are compelled with you and that movie and stuff. So I think it does.
When JFK.
Yeah, people are interested in your other movies.
He told something, and when he told it. You listen to him.
Yeah.
I was just there for one day. I came and went.
Well, it's one of those parts that kind of stand out.
It's kind of the same as this.
Yeah, yeah. Here you come, you go. But not quite leaving the brilliance on that film.
So I'm failing here.
No,
I can take it.
We're failing you. Please.
In that monologue, but that is what, that kind of summed up everything everybody felt about that whole assassination in that monologue. Like, the rest of the movie was great. Even though I think Oswald did it, but I think that monologue was fucking summed up what everybody thought about.
It's not whether or not Oswald did it. It's whether what was behind Oswald doing it.
Mm.
That's kind of just the window dressing. Keep the people guessing. It's like a parlor game.
You're doing lines at Donald Sutherland.
I can't help it. It's Donald Sutherland.
Way too late, guys. Way too late.
Hunger Games, though. See that, really.
Of course.
That's what we're talking about.
I can't wait to see it.
Do you pay attention to the criticism or the positive reviews that a film like this gets? Like, or do you not care what people say either way? Or do you? Does it bother you and make you feel great?
Are you going to say something bad?
No.
No. I know. It's okay. It's okay.
Because you were saying the Twitter stuff was really positive.
But the Twitter stuff is only, that's just exit polls, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's people coming out of the movie saying, I loved it. Mm-hmm. And that's wonderful. That means something. Because nowadays, in this modern society, people coming out of a movie saying, this one sucks, it just kills it. Suddenly, the rest of the weekend goes in the toilet. And this one was never, ever projected to be 155. Max, it was thought maybe 138.
Mm.
Wow.
It just went through the roof.
That's got to make you
happy. Read the book to prepare? You said you read the script, but then did you read the book to learn more about your character, or did you say no?
No, I didn't want to know it. Course I read it.
Oh.
I just told him I spent 3 months preparing for this monologue.
For 20 minutes.
I thought you meant for JFK. I thought you meant for JFK.
He did.
You meant for JFK, didn't you?
No, he did, yeah.
No, I meant for Hunger Games.
I was talking about JFK. You said you spent 3 months preparing for that monologue to absorb everything.
Yeah, I know. But you were just asking me if I read the book about Hunger Games.
Or did you maybe want to make character decisions that you didn't want to know what the book said because you couldn't bring that in? Or did you want to? I didn't know. That's why I asked.
You guys really are very brave.
Why are we brave?
Sit with him all this time. This is how many? 30 million people have read this book.
Wow.
This is a movie in the imaginations of 30 million people. Mm. And 30 million people are going to be happy with the movie that Gary Ross has made. But to be a part of their imagination, obviously I had to read the book that their imaginations movie was based on.
I was just afraid if I said, did you enjoy the book, you would yell at me and go, I didn't read the book. Why would I read the book? I'm playing the part.
See, you screwed up, Jimmy.
I know, I really, there's no good answer here.
That's what we're all finding out.
It's no winning.
Well, they upset one of my favorite people.
I don't think so.
No, I'm in love with you. I didn't know how to bring it up. You gave me an opportunity. But you come out of the movie feeling so happy. Just if young people will recognize that they've been a dormant generation, and if they can just get it together to, you know, this is a movie for the 99%.
Yeah.
They should stand up and do something.
Did you think Occupy was a good thing? Like, at least it got people moving? Or?
Oh, my God. Of course it was a good thing. It was a wonderful thing. It still is a wonderful thing, you know.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. You know, when you have people...
I like it. Ant said, really.
Oh, I'm over here going, really?
Yeah, Ant said, really.
No. When you have people standing up saying, we don't care that you're rich. We just care that you're trying to buy our government. Those are people that you can believe in.
Yeah, but then they do care that you're rich.
No, they don't. No, they kind of do. Well, they care if you're rich, if you're... See, if you have somebody like, what's his name, Stephen Schwartzman, you know, who says that Obama, when he tries to close that corporate tax loophole, when he says that, when he draws a parallel between that and the Nazis invading Poland, yeah, sure, take his $4.7 billion, because he doesn't owe it. You know, but when you have General Electric... who makes $4 billion in profit and doesn't pay any tax and gets a rebate, yeah, sure, come on. Mm. You know, Oliver Wendell Holmes said taxes are what you pay for a civilized society.
Yeah, but when do you think it kind of stops a little bit and gets a little more... You know, they can't keep taking. My God, it gets a little...
But it's the people that aren't paying,
see? That's what I mean. They keep taking in, and that's what I mean. The young people have to realize that it's their identity to take hold of and their destiny to realize and stop the taking, you know?
I mean the taxes they keep taking from me.
I'm talking about... No.
I don't like being taxed a lot.
Well, then you don't like a civilized society.
He doesn't. He's very uncivilized. You should see him eat with his hands. It's disgusting.
I can't believe they got me on this show.
Yeah, I
he's
know.
He's part of the 1%.
You actually have listeners.
Yeah,
can you believe it?
Boy, do we.
I know. It really is astounding.
I was listening to NPR. I'm sorry.
Wow.
I was listening to NPR.
That's the
I came out of my house and
would
I
Would
drove,
you have insomnia?
I have insomnia. I was driving on the PCH heading towards the McClure Tunnel, and the young woman was interviewing Willie Nelson on the occasion of his 75th anniversary. And it was, I just heard the tail end of it. It was a wonderful interview. And she was fine. She was very young. And as I got into the tunnel, she said, is there anything, it was the end of the interview, is there anything about being 75 that has surprised you? And he said, yes. You could hear in her voice how excited she was because she thought, I've got a scoop. This is it. She said, and what was that? And he said, I never thought that I would outlive my penis.
No.
You could tell. Heavy traffic on the 10 going east, right?
Yeah.
In Los Angeles. One out of every six cars went out of control.
That's a great line, man.
That's Willie, though, yeah.
Yeah, we've had Willie.
Yeah, he is...
He likes his pot.
He'll say whatever the hell
he loves
wants.
His pot.
I'm 43, and I'm already in a Cialis binge. I don't know how anybody makes it to 75 and keeps a solid rod. We're going to talk about that stuff. I require medication.
Jesus, this is the most depressing show.
No, that should be, that's uplifting.
That was uplifting.
Yeah, right, that was uplifting.
You know, yeah. If it were uplifting, terrific. But then you wouldn't need the Cialis.
Yeah, literally. Yeah.
So, Hunger Games.
Have you ever refused the role because you didn't like the tone of it or that you thought the movie itself was giving the wrong message?
He doesn't like your questions.
He doesn't like.
Do you like? Okay. Do you like his questions?
John Borman came and lived beside me for 2 weeks. I love John Borman. His twins came and played with my twins. He wanted me to do a movie called Deliverance, and I said no. I do not. I said, can you believe it? No, I do not want to do violent films. So he went and he cast John Voight and made Deliverance.
Mm.
Sam Peckinpah said, please do Straw Dogs. I said, no, I do not want to do films that are violent. And then I went to play a fascist in Novecento who killed a kid by swinging him around his head.
Oh, Jesus.
And the part they offered you in Straw Dogs, I guess, was Hoffman's part? Yeah. Or was it one of the...
Yeah. No, it was her part, but I said I. Yeah, no, it was the part that Dustin eventually played. But yeah, I have to. Alan Alda, have you ever talked
to him? I love, yes, he's one of my favorite people.
One of the great, great gentlemen. And I'd never met him. I was standing beside him in a lineup to meet the Queen Mother at a film, but a royal film performance in London. And I saw that it was him, but we hadn't actually met. And his elbow hit my side, and I leaned in, because you couldn't look sideways, because you had to face the Prince Philip, actually, and the Queen Mum. And he leaned over towards me, and he said, "I want to thank you for my life." Wow. And it was the most elegant, wonderful thing. Just what a...
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, beautiful, eh? Really beautiful.
That's all right, man.
Do you like the show? Is it weird to watch someone else play a role that you've played?
I have to be truthful, I've never seen it. But then I haven't seen either. I mean, I've saw half of it, but I haven't seen the whole thing.
You ever watched the show?
I didn't watch the show, and I've only seen half the movie.
Why do you guys do that?
But do you know how wrong it is that you just said to me and Donald Sutherland, why do you guys do that? Like, we're both doing the same thing.
No, I mean, we've heard it from other actors. Why won't you watch some of your own work? I don't get that.
Because it's not my own work. I mean, I give somebody else my work, and they take it. And,
but I mean, your own performance, I guess.
But they take my performance and change it around. It's not me. I don't give a shit. But my character... You know, early on, I'd never seen Clute, for example, really protests because they've taken my arm and put it on my ear and that kind of stuff, you know?
And that bothers you, obviously.
It bothers my character.
Was that bad?
No, it bothers my character.
Is that bad?
The look he gives you. The look he gives you.
You'll be very happy that Dick Cheney has a new heart.
Well,
you'll be very happy to know that he has a heart.
I wouldn't wish ill of anybody. So yeah, if you know he gets a new heart,
he might have been a Cheney guy.
How does the donor's family feel?
Well, I guess that depends on their political affiliation, but I'm sure they would rather have whoever the donor was in their life than Dick Cheney having a new heart.
He probably jumped the line in front of a few people,
no,
too.
No, please. No, he didn't. It took 20 months.
Yeah,
right?
He was on the waiting list for a while.
But, I mean, to get a heart transplant when you're 71.
Yeah, that's going to take over. That'll take a while.
That means he knows some people.
Yeah. You think?
Oh, come on.
I don't know.
Remember Mickey Mantle getting his liver?
That was a travesty. Yeah.
He drank through that second liver in 2 weeks.
Oh, did he? I saw a guy with a heart transplant in Canada sitting in the window of his fish market smoking cigarettes. He was gray.
Wow, really?
You know, and this was in Canada, and so we pay for it. And
I went in
and I said, "Listen, mother, you know, I don't give a shit what you do with yourself, but that's my heart. I paid for that."
So repoed it right there on it.
Do you and not watching yourself, have you seen like Ordinary People or your performance at JFK?
Ordinary People, my God. Bob insisted I go see it. Halfway through it, I got down in between the seats and crawled out of the
theater.
Why?
Why?
You're so good in that.
You're great in that.
You're so good in that.
You should see the Hunger Games because I'm really good
at that. I will see that.
We're going to see the Hunger Games.
Well, it's a testament to how great
I love my character in the Hunger Games. Gary Ross did just such a wonderful job of creating this, because he wrote scenes in the Rose Garden that Suzanne Collins is totally enthusiastic about, but that weren't in the book. That really,
they added some things in that weren't in the book.
To define for people the nature of this oligarchy of privilege that that this allegory is about.
Hey, have you seen the movie?
Have I seen the movie? I've seen the movie twice. Oh yeah, Kiefer, when I was not going to see Six, God, the tea is really, I'm allergic to it. I just burped. Six Degrees of Separation opened, Kiefer went in to see it, and I stayed outside with Fred Skepsy, the director, and went to have some. And he came out and he said, "Dad, you really have to go see this one." So I went to see it, and I was okay. You know, I mean, it was like having vertigo or something, you know, you get over it. And I got over it. So I go see everything now.
Oh, okay.
You're in that with Stockard Channing, I think. Didn't she play you away? That was great. Yeah. Do you get embarrassed watching yourself? Like, if I act, I get embarrassed watching myself. And
well,
I probably
should. So does the audience.
I should get embarrassed.
It's incredible that he leaves himself open like that.
I know. Believe me.
Wow.
And it's very rare of these guys to hit me below the belt.
You should never be embarrassed about your work.
Oh, shit. Donald, who do you play in Hunger Games? We should get the basics out there for the people that haven't seen the film.
I play Coriolanus Snow, who is the president of Pan Am.
That seems
He's
like
He's 76 years old. Mm-hmm. He's beautiful. No, he's great. He really
he's
is great.
Staring at Opie.
Yeah. I'm hanging in there, though, man. Yeah. I'm staring right back at him. Yeah. I'm trying.
Were you nervous when you had to?
Don't do it.
When I came in here, I was terrible. Absolutely terrible. I thought, gosh, look at these three wits.
I was going to say going through the audition process, but yeah. I couldn't say.
Oh, my God.
Don't look at him.
When is the last time you auditioned for something? Like how many years has it been since you've had to do that?
Two.
No.
Oh, no. Hey, you know something? After Ordinary People, I couldn't get an audition. I couldn't get a meeting for 1 year.
Why?
I couldn't get a job.
Why?
There are other people you have to ask, because I thought, I'm ready. No, I couldn't get a job. Weird, eh?
I was joking. I figured you hadn't gotten an audition since MASH, but you'll still have to occasionally ask you to read for something?
Oh, sure, yeah. You know, and they'll say things like, he's wrong for this. He doesn't do comedy. I say, I can tell you a joke.
But you did MASH.
Precisely.
Yeah.
I did Kelly's Heroes. Do you ever see Kelly's
Heroes? Oh, I love Kelly's Heroes. Come on, it's great.
It's on all the
Clint Eastwood.
No.
Oh, it was wonderful.
It's a great cast.
Oh, yeah.
And I resent the fact that those two, when I said I hadn't seen it, both went over the top with how much they loved it to further humiliate an emasculate.
Well, we're trying to pile on now, Jimmy.
When I was a kid, I went to the movie theater in Central Islip, and all day on a Saturday sat there with my friend, and we just watched it over and over
again.
It's
a long movie. So what are you saying? Tickets weren't selling?
Do you know how bad it makes you feel when they say, when I was a
That's
kid.
Why he said it.
He's just trying to hurt
you.
No.
Stick it to you right?
Believe me.
That was him trying to hurt you.
It's all about taxation. It's back to that again.
Yes. Don't tax me this much. I'm barely holding on.
So what was the first job you got after Ordinary People?
Max Dugan Returns.
Oh, man. Yeah.
And they offered it to you or they wanted you to read for it?
No, it was a supporting role. No, they didn't ask me to read for it. Though, Herb Ross, he's dead now, was the director. And it's a film where my son plays baseball. And he just doesn't have anything to do. He just had one line. There's just one little scene. And Kiefer was there. He would have been 16, I guess. I said to Herb, can my son just do this? He's not acted. He's played an extra. He was interested in it. And Herb Ross said, I have to audition him. And he took him into his trailer for 2 hours and came back out and said, no. No, this is, he can't do it. And he got some guy, I don't know. Anyway, with all respect.
What? Wow. Why did he say no? He couldn't have been that bad.
No, he wasn't bad at all. He was terrific, you know.
God, you think he would do you a favor? You're Donald Sutherland, for God's sake.
Yeah,
that's
really.
What I thought.
But when you look back and the guy's like,
that's what I thought.
Who says he's not funny? He's quick. It's Donald Sutherland's quick.
What a shitty decision that is. And Kiefer's in one of the biggest shows in the last 50 years.
And he's a wonderful actor.
He's a great actor.
And a fantastic man.
Yeah.
We did Letterman
together.
And
we're doing a movie. We're going to do a movie. Redemption.
You are.
We did.
Yeah. You knew it?
No. I did not know that. I think you said, did I really do Letterman with him? I said yes.
Letterman.
Yeah, you were on Leno with Kiefer.
Yes.
Have you guys ever worked together?
What?
No,
he's trying to brag is what he's trying to do.
Yeah, he is trying to brag to you.
He's trying to brag.
Well, I remember when Kiefer came off, he did his segment first, and he had said that Donald, I think he said, had never won an Oscar, and I was shocked by that.
I couldn't win an Oscar.
Of course you could.
No, I've never been nominated.
Oh, well, that helps.
No. Maybe that was what he said. That was the shocking part.
Wait. Do you remember Johnny Carson?
Sure.
Milton, do you know who Ramsey Clark is?
Yes.
Was? Yeah. He was the attorney general for Lyndon Johnson. And he was on Johnny Carson. Milton Berle had been there originally. You know, Milton Berle did the opening, and he was sitting down beside Ed McMahon. And Ramsey Clark and Johnny Carson, were, this would have been in the early, very early 70s, were talking about how to get out of Vietnam, how to end the Vietnam War. And they were just having a conversation, you know, and not coming up, I must say, with any solution. And Milton Berle was waving his hand like that, like to the radio listeners, I'm waving my hand. Johnny finally said, "Yes, Milton." And Milton said, I can tell you how to end the war." And Ramsey Clark turned around and looked at him, and Johnny said, "How can we end the war, Milton?" He said, "Well, you put it on ABC, they'll cancel it in 3 months."
Oh, damn, that's good.
Hunger Games.
Yes.
I'm going.
Hunger Games.
It's wonderful.
And it was really sold out.
Yeah. Oh, no, I believe you.
$155 million.
You have an honest-looking face.
Oh, boy. Yes.
But if he said that...
Yeah. I'm a little more... Well, political affiliation has nothing to do with who I find entertaining or who I would be friends with.
I hope not, because you'd be alone in a room.
Hey, God. They didn't kill you off in this movie, right? You'll be
in the four.
More than one yet? Sometimes they do, you know that.
They're making the second one this summer.
Right.
And then the third and the fourth. And they have to, you know, do them quickly because I'm 76.
Well, you know, if you took that Animal House deal, that's like $200,000.
Oh, you brought up the Animal House.
What?
I thought, why would you
bring up the Animal House?
And then it would be like $50,000 a pop.
Oh, boy, I'm sorry.
I'd have to bring
I'm sorry.
Up.
Why are you bringing
I, I'm sorry. I just felt like we were all kind of getting together and getting along.
No, we're not. You just read that completely. I feel totally alienated.
I'm sorry, sir.
I'm out of tea. I'm miserable.
I was trying to...
So there's going to be at least four movies. That's cool.
I want to ask you that. Can I ask an actor question?
Yeah, maybe you'll get to see the fourth.
What? Can I ask an acting question?
Oh, boy.
Oh, he's looking at me.
Yeah,
I'm trying
blue
to prepare
eyes.
An answer for you.
How do you, when you read something...
Timing.
How do you make it yours? How do you make it your... Like you said, you didn't memorize the JFK per se. You kind of just soaked it all in. How do you look at dialogue?
I knew it word for word. What I'm saying is... there's a difference between memorizing and knowing. The end result is the same, except the end result for memorized is that it comes out by rote. It sounds like certain political speakers, you know.
Right.
But if you know it, then it just sounds as if you're talking, like I'm talking to you, as opposed to reading off the teleprompter.
Hmm. And that comes from just absolutely going over it and going over it.
Yeah, getting it so that it's an integral part of you. Yeah. Are you an actor?
I'm a comedian. Oh. I do a little bit of acting, but my acting is, let's be honest, it's okay.
Well, okay is good. I thought you were going to say it was terrible.
I should have.
Roland is freaking out over here.
We
got to
wrap up.
Has to go.
Can I ask Donald something?
Man.
Did you have fun today?
Did I have fun here?
Yeah.
Oh,
I need to know.
It's finished. No, I actually had a wonderful time. Two of you are really terrific. Yeah.
But it's him is the one you don't like.
Of course it is.
He's the problem.
I
enjoyed the hell out of this.
Yeah, we loved it.
Okay. Donald.
Hunger Games is in theaters now, and obviously we're absolutely going to go see it.
You don't need a lot of help from us promoting it.
I know. I don't even know why you're here. You could have taken this hour off. You don't need to promote this.
I flew in from Los Angeles last night. I fly back this afternoon.
Wow.
And as to your question of you don't know why I'm here?
I don't know why. And he's rolling his own luggage. It's very confusing.
Yeah.
Very confused by this Donald.
That really was a great entrance. He just walked by and gave us the finger and left his luggage there. Yeah. We're an odd man.
I'll never wash that finger. Goodbye, everybody.
All right, thank you. Donald Sutherland. Hunger Games, obviously in theaters now.
Can I just find my little murder?
Sirius XM. And now, the Opie and Anthony Show.
It's almost time to go home. It's almost time to go, oh, oh, oh. It's almost time to go home.
It's almost time to go. Oh, oh, oh. It's almost time to go. Oh, 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 oh.
Donald Sutherland in studio today. Oh, my God.
That was great.
I got to tell you, one of my favorite interviews of all time.
Yeah, he was...
just in general. It was just an amazing experience. I fucking loved it.
He's a legend, so having him in here is really cool. And then he's such a sarcastic.
When you figure that out, at first I was gulping. I was like
oh,
why
no.
did I say that? And then you realize he's just a sarcastic son of a bitch with quick comedic timing.
Man. Yep.
Oh, I love that. Very God.
Funny. That was cool. I'm glad, because like, I love those movies, and have them come in here and not be a dick is pretty cool.
Because for me, it's very easy to bitch, obviously, but the other side of it, I fucking love today. That was fucking
that was good.
I told my brother, because he goes, how cool is that? I go, dude, it just fucking, I go beyond.
Yeah.
Today's one of those days where I just fucking realize I love what I do, and I consider myself lucky.
Yeah, that was very
so
cool.
much fun. And he really had a good time. He just hung out for 10 minutes, by the way. He had another interview, and he just hung out during the whole break. He was spraying Jimmy with his cologne.
With his cologne, yeah.
And then, I don't know, they brought the cologne back in because Jimmy wants it now.
Jimmy, I think he's trying to steal it.
I think he's trying to negotiate for the cologne right now.
Oh, he'll put that up somewhere in his house. And Donald Sutherland's perfume.
Well, then Creepy Jimmy had to drink his tea that he left behind.
Did he?
Yeah, he drank his tea. The tea's right there. That's the tea that Donald Sutherland was drinking.
Maybe he'll get the essence of Donald Sutherland, be able to like act better.
You never know. Part of Donald Sutherland goes into Jimmy.
That was pretty cool.
And I was saying, it just amazes me when these guys come in, these huge, over-the-top, famous fucking people, and they don't see their own work.
They haven't seen, like, MASH yet.
You think he actually did, but it's cool to say he didn't?
No, he seems too... I believe him.
He's at the point he doesn't have to lie for anything
What else
to
didn't
anybody.
He see? He didn't see ordinary people?
No, because he said that Kiefer, after... Oh, he said that on the air. 6 Degrees of Separation.
Yeah,
Kiefer
yeah.
said, you got to see this one, Dad. And then he went and saw it, and he's seen those since. But no, I believe him. He's probably one of those guys that just... Spencer Tracy was like that.
Because it bothers him when he realizes what they do with his performance.
Yeah.
I've never heard that before from some of these guys. They're bothered by it because they see it another way in their head when they're acting it out, and then they see the final product and
after
go, what the fuck? You moved my shit around.
E-Rock, please email me those pictures today. There's a picture.
Today, how about you do it immediately?
Right now, so I can Twitter one. There's a
please.
How about I'm doing it right now?
Oh, shit!
Oh, why don't you just spit on the boss?
He
He's
just told
for something.
You pretty much that was saying shut the fuck up.
I know. E-Rock's
E-Rock just said shut the fuck up.
I'm losing the fucking E-Rock thing today.
Oh, man.
He's
please.
Kicking my ass.
Today, we've watched E-Rock go from the young boy who looked at you and looked up at you, and you were just amazing.
Yeah, I am.
And now...
Amazing. What?
But now we're looking like...
Amazing.
Now.
What happened?
Now he's reached those teen years where he's rebelling against you. And
but behind the scenes, I've told E-Rock all I ever wanted from this kid... was for him to fight back. That's all I ever wanted. And
well,
now he is.
Now look at what you got.
And now I wish I never told him
you
that.
Fucking created a monster.
He's kicking my ass.
Is he on Twitter, Sutherland?
I don't know.
He came, he had a great time. And that was we were off air when he was signing stuff. And then I asked him, like, what was the cologne? And I forget, there's some French name.
Yeah.
So he fucking goes into his luggage. They're waiting for him to go to other press. He goes into his luggage and gets it. He calls me back in. And sits there and sprays me with his cologne.
Then he sprayed some on his neck.
you're not gonna shower for a couple days.
I wouldn't have anyway. So now my balls will still stink. But I'll still wash my balls.
Yeah, wash your balls. Keep that neck not washed.
Fuck,
I want to smell Donald Sutherland for a few days.
Donald Sutherland sprayed me with cologne.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, I was too scared to say it. A lot of people did the math. He lost out on $2.8 million.
2.8. Yeah. Jesus.
And he made $50,000.
Yeah, 50 grand.
I think it was 50 grand for his day's work.
That's his day's work.
And he could have made
2.8. You're going to pay me my day's pay.
What?
Wow.
What?
Truth is on your side, Bubba. And that's a day's pay in 1978 was 50K.
Yeah.
That's a lot of fucking money.
I bet you the 2.8 is higher.
It probably is. And he'd probably still be getting, like, every so often, here's your Animal House.
Oh, God,
sir.
Yeah. It's much higher. He lost a lot of money, but I mean, he's probably made so much since then.
Oh, you think?
Yeah.
Being Donald Sutherland.
Yeah.
And with this movie.
Is there any Little Murders there? You can't find that, right? I bet you on YouTube there's none of it. He was so fucking great. He only had one scene. He plays a preacher.
Oh. Why'd you bring that movie in for him to sign? That's weird.
Because it's such
out of everything he's done. I see you did bring in your JFK.
I brought in the disc. I didn't have the box because Little Murders is one of my favorite Sutherland performers. Otto turned me on to it years ago, and it's he's so. I don't even know if they'll show him in the trailer, but he just he does a wedding, and Vincent Gardenia pays him to mention God because his daughter's marrying an atheist.
Right.
And he's just very entertaining.
People want us to explain the Sutherland Animal House thing. I think we just did. Basically, they offered him
2%
of the movie. Or a day's pay, which was $50,000 for him back then. And some people did the math, said it was at least $2.8 million he passed up on.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't know. He didn't know that Animal House was going to be as great as it was. What was the other thing he said that I couldn't believe? He was never nominated for an Oscar? Is that
never.
Possible?
Yeah, never. No.
Was he just busting balls in
there? No. That was what Kiefer said. Never, but then as I was saying it, I hesitated because I'm like, did he win for fucking
even for you know, supporting?
No, nothing.
Come on, that's crazy. Like, yeah. That seems crazy.
I think he wrote W and then that's an O R K. I think it says work on it.
Or oh, maybe Jimmy Work.
Jimmy Work on it. Maybe you're acting.
Oh, work on it. Yeah, okay, probably. Because he signed Little Murders for me, and then he went back in and he wrote something else.
Yeah.
He didn't like your political views, sir.
None of them do. None of them do, but he's, you know, Hollywood fucking elite.
He's fucking...
He's one of the royalty.
He really is.
I give him a pass on anything.
There's no one... There's no actor in Hollywood he couldn't be comfortable with. Like, he worked... They listed who he worked with fucking... He's worked with Brando, obviously De Niro, Sarandon, Mary Tyler Moore, Will Smith, Oliver Stone, Michael Douglas, Hoffman, Freeman, Clint Eastwood... Like, there's nobody... Oh, there he is. Oh, he's so great.
The only one he'd be... That's so cool. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. The only one he'd be in line with, like, with Alan Alda standing in a line would be to meet the Queen. You know? They're all just, like, fucking amazing actors.
Thank you for my life.
Thank you for my
Don't
life.
Don't we have stories like that?
Yeah.
Just like that, right?
We're in line at Starbucks.
Right.
We
run into Danny Bonaducci. That's our equivalent story.
That's it.
At a burger joint once.
Right.
Wow. We're just like Donald Sutherland.
Well, it's a good cologne. It's Vietnam. When he was saying words like Vietnam, he was reminding me so much of his character in JFK because to hear him say that Vietnam in certain things, I could just hear that fucking monologue. Fuck, was he good, man.
That was fun, man. I really enjoyed the hell out of that.
Yeah.
Why don't we get the fuck out of here?
I'm so happy he had fun, too.
Jimmy Caroline's sold out, probably?
No, but it is selling very well. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 212-757-4100.
Nice.
For tickets. And I'm going to Washington, D.C. in a couple weeks. First gigs ever.
Washington.
At the D.C. Improv. Which will be the 12th through the 14th of April. April 12th through 14th, I'll be at DC at the Improvisation.
Why are we
still here?
Still on the air.
Because I still have Donald Sutherland fever.
Oh, my fucking Sutherland picture. I look like a fucking...
A what?
I don't know.
Hot stud with a
fucking
V?
Dope.
With a good body.
Fuck yeah, man. That body looks pretty smoking.
A stupid fucking picture.
You agree, Sam?
Oh, yeah.
All right, let's calm down.
Look at that bod.
You have a lot of my interviews on a hard drive. I gave Sam a hard drive to put my interviews on, and I know he's not putting them on there.
I am putting them on.
I know he's not, because he's
of
fucking...
Of course he is.
No, he's not. He's too busy fucking positioning his wrestling pictures. Like, oh, Jim wants this Michael K. Williams interview, but first, I want to make fucking Macho Man's feet do this.
Do you think I've taken it out of the box?
No.
Oh, no. I hope so.
It's time to... Can we go?
Yeah. I mean, technically, you still have four
Shut
minutes.
Up, Sam.
I agree, Sammy.
Fuck. The Opie and Anthony show is pretty much over.
Pretty much over. Pretty much over.
But if you feel like sticking around after 1A Live is next.